Om Shanti, and welcome to this special conversation with our guest, Brother Kiran Mani. He is the Managing Director of Sales at Google USA. He's been previously working with Microsoft India, heading their marketing, and he's also been an entrepreneur. He is coming all the way from San Francisco, USA. He's a father, a son, and he's a family man. Of course, he's working. And most importantly, he has been practicing Raj Yoga meditation for last 7 years. So we are going to know about his experience. Welcome, Brother Mani.
Om Shanti, sister. Thank you for having me.
Om Shanti. You know, Google is the buzzword. Sometimes I've heard people saying, if you can't connect with anything above, you know, you just go to Google. It's either God or Google. You know, that is the way Google has taken space in everyone's life across globally. And I think you know about it. So coming from that background, and you've also had headed certain great IT companies, and of course what you're doing now is immense work. Tell us about your journey. How did you started this spiritual practice, which I understand that you are now into meditation, and meditation is a part of your life.
Sister, it's interesting you say about Google's definition with God. There is in one of the churches in the US, I believe there was a saying written outside that if you don't find answers here, ask Google. jokes aside, I think 7 years ago, my journey on meditation primarily started with that premise that I actually looked at my job, I looked at Google, and I kind of felt that the answers to most of life's questions lay outside, right? Mm-hmm. I genuinely believed that if I had a question, if I had answer, there's knowledge outside, mm-hmm. which I could Google it, I could get it in.
Of course.
And, a little bit of my background will help. I come from a typical middle-class Indian home where I was grown up on the values of education, mm-hmm. and, the values of my religious beliefs, mm-hmm. as the foundations of what is a good ethical life. You know, you study really hard, you pray really well. So it was more a ritualistic life.
Mm-hmm. It's like a perfect life if you're studying.
That's right. You know, I was called it quintessential, the good boy of home, because I did all the right things in terms of being ritualistic, in terms of good with my prayers. Mm-hmm. I was the hardworking student, which was helpful. But I think when I started progressing through life, it also then leads to certain very logical next steps, mm-hmm. which is you start seeing success as your monetary benefits that you come in. Mm-hmm. You start seeing that, and nothing wrong about it. But over a period of time, what happens is your success starts to become your own, it starts to put barriers between your connecting with your own inner self. Mm-hmm. And for me, that tipping point happened about 7 years ago, mm-hmm. where perhaps in my life, I should have been at my happiest moment, mm-hmm. that from where I started my career, I had reached a point where I had achieved way beyond even my dreams. Mm-hmm. My financial objectives had been met. Mm-hmm. I should have been very, very satisfied in terms of the professional career progressions that I've made. Mm-hmm. I could see a lot of pride in my parents' eyes on where I had met it. Mm-hmm. Yet I would recall that moment as one of the most unhappy moments in my life.
Mm-hmm. Could you explain more around it?
Yeah, I think there was a lot of information in my head. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of aspirations on where I wanted to head it. But I think three things contributed to that. Now when I look back, three things contributed to that, call it that state of unhappiness. Mm-hmm. I was filled with expectations from everything around me. I had expectations about what people should do at work. I had expectations about how things should happen at home. I had expectations from my family. I was dying under the weight of my own expectations, even of myself, of what I should be doing. I had plans about in 5 years what I wanted to become. Second, I was extremely judgmental. What happens is success started becoming my own enemy, mm-hmm. that all of a sudden on everything, I had a very quick opinion about what was right or what was wrong. Not that anybody told me why should I be right, but yes, I was placing that impetus outside. The other one was you know, when I kept my hand like this, I always had tilted it towards me. It was all about what I receive.
Mm-hmm.
And in the process, what I had found was I could call myself the richest beggar who was walking around. I was begging for attention. I was begging for people's acceptance, mm-hmm. In spite of having all the richness within. And I think it is in that moment that I turned to meditation as my way.
Mm-hmm.
And to your initial question, I think while Google has the answers to the outside, there is no knowing what is the true knowledge which is actually inside you. And that's a self-experimentation or a self-exploration process that I started 7 years ago.
You know, coming from you that Google has answers, and it has answers for everything, but it doesn't have answer for what is inside of us. And very interestingly, when you stated that, you know, you were at that envious and aspirational position where people want to be, have a good family and go to the US, and get a job in Google.
Yeah.
And then it's so surprising that it's what people think that's what is going to bring them happiness. And here we have an example who says, well, not really. You know, you talked about serenity, calmness. And when I look at you, I can see that coming. At the same time, in the corporate world, or especially in the IT, you've got, and sales as well, you've got these targets, you're competitive, and you've got to be aggressive also. And so how does the serenity, you know, you're talking about calmness. I'm not a monk. I'm not a, you know, I'm not a saint.
Yeah.
I need to be progressive. I'm young. What is your take on that?
I think, sister, in the very things that you said, the two things which I have found as common misconceptions about in my own small experiments with meditation is many people think that meditation is only meant for two types of people.
Mm-hmm.
Either people who have gotten something very wrong in life, that, hey, I have gone through some major crisis in life, or people who have given up everything in life and who want to take a practice of this as a monk.
Jobless, maybe.
You know, or yeah, call it saying that my full-time job is to become a monk.
Mm.
But I think the vast majority of people who lie between those two are the ones who have immense benefit out of this.
Mm-hmm.
Because as you rightly said, again, I will, given the background that I come from,
mm-hmm.
I'll look for scientific reasons as to why it should be done. Not that I answer it.
Mm-hmm.
But it is now increasingly being proven that your intuition is far stronger than your intellect.
Mm-hmm.
Your heart brain is 10 times more powerful than your brain.
Mm-hmm.
And your ability to hone that intuition,
mm-hmm.
you know, even in a professional context, mm-hmm. has immense benefits.
Mm-hmm.
There is again enough number of books that say
mm-hmm.
your entire knowledge that you bring in
mm-hmm.
only allows you to take certain very small linear decision making.
Mm-hmm.
You know, once you know 2 + 2 = 4, that is arithmetic. But what you do with it is all based on intuition. It's all based on interpersonal skills. It's
mm-hmm.
all based on creating a happy workplace. Here's another stat which, you know, which I found to be surprising,
mm-hmm.
that when you actually differentiate the world's greatest workplaces
mm-hmm.
over a period of 50 or 60 years, the companies that have consistently done better than other companies who are competitions and who have been around have been companies which have valued happiness as a key index.
Mm-hmm.
People in companies which do really well over a period of time are happy. Nobody can define happiness, but I think that's where the aspect of meditation and the ability to work in a community, the ability mm-hmm. to share, really comes in. And I think that's where, to me, you don't have to be a monk, you don't have to be somebody who has gotten things right, but to know your inner self,
mm-hmm.
to know that we are all interconnected human beings, we all draw the power from one central divine source,
mm-hmm.
Makes us understand each other, work with each other. To your point, then suddenly there is no stress, there is only purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Suddenly there is no conflict, there is no need to be harsh with each other.
Mm-hmm.
As long as purpose is known, we all realize that we are all in the same journey together,
mm-hmm.
and things get done in a much more mm-hmm. calmer, happier way.
Very beautifully you've put it all together. And you know, to break the stereotypical thinking, when you label it, sometimes people who actually feel they need to do it, or you know, get more serious about introducing meditation in their lives, they shy away, given the fact that, you know, I'm too young for it, or I'm too, you know, I'm competitive, I have to show that I have, you know, I'm progressing in my world. But if we understand that it's actually for everyone, for the benefit.
Yes.
And mostly, you know, also when people are stressed, it is also a scientific fact that meditation is the key to de-stress.
Yes.
It is where your the core of your stress, which is inside you, that is where it, you know, it removes it. But many people do many other things, which is good in their perspective. But how do you see that, well, how do you tell a person who's really under stress and who thinks that maybe just going out is good enough, or just, you know, listening to music is good enough?
Yeah. Sister, I think again, you know, yes, listening to music, going out and having a party after, you know, as a matter of celebration. In a lot of ways, all these, call it experiential happiness, what I find is it still only stimulates your senses.
Mm-hmm.
You come back after a party, for people who go out, have a drink, come back. The next day morning is not a very pleasant experience.
Mm-hmm.
When you listen to music, yes, you might be able to numb your stress,
mm-hmm.
but when the music stops, the voices from within start to emerge again.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, we all spend enormous amount of days, years,
mm-hmm.
educating our brain on how to do certain basic things, right? Arithmetic,
mm-hmm.
language. But we all forget that turning within and the ability to call it exercise control on how your thoughts are, it's almost as if we have one of the most miraculous machinery sitting within,
mm-hmm.
yet we spend so little time in understanding that machinery and making sure that you put that to good use.
Mm-hmm.
We are so obsessed about putting that machinery to external use and experiencing
mm-hmm.
the experiential aspect,
mm-hmm.
that we forget that this machinery can be controlled from within.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a joy in doing that,
mm-hmm.
which can, you know, which cannot be explained unless and until you spend time on it. And which, by the way, if you look at the Western school, which basically is the one that perpetrated today's form of education,
mm-hmm.
they are all going back to this, to call it the science of meditation now. You know, call it gene hacking, call it positive psychology. Most professors, most people who go on a scientific endeavor find that science stops where spirituality begins,
mm-hmm.
and that true happiness, true realization of self potential comes in when you actually turn within.
Mm-hmm. It's very beautifully that you've put that there is a limit to whatever we can do with science, with being logical, with being practical, but then we are missing out on that immense power that's really within. We are missing out on the power of intuition, and which of course only when we practice meditation can we awaken that power.
Yeah.
You know, you have been practicing meditation for the last 7 years, which is like a long time. What is the change or transformation that you've witnessed? Let's begin with your workplace.
Yeah.
Is there a change or transformation that you witnessed with whatever you do, how things are happening around you, and also with how people look at you? Has there been a comment, or you feel that you've changed?
The change has been night and day.
Mm-hmm. For the good?
I definitely feel
mm-hmm.
Enormously fulfilled.
Mm-hmm.
And in a lot of ways, I'm very thankful to the Brahma Kumaris for making that happen. I still remember my first video was a video of Sister Shivani
mm-hmm.
Speaking about meditation. And at that time, I used to scoff at it, you know. My feeling was, why do I need anybody to teach me about mindfulness and meditation? I knew how to live life. I knew how to come in. But the fact was, again, it came from a point of ignorance to mm-hmm. find out there is an inner power to come in. So to your question, I think the biggest change that I've seen is what I don't do consciously.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I find is that there is a conscious behavior which all of us can influence. But that requires you to be consistently in the moment. And, you know, it's always possible that when you are made very aware that you have to remain calm, that you have to act logically. All of us are intelligent enough to know that that's important. But it's when we react to situations, when things go bad, when your subconscious starts to kick in. I think that's where all your practice of meditation really starts to show. When there is a moment of stress at work, when you actually feel that somebody's hurrying you up. Consistent meditation practice changes you from correcting your mistakes to preventing those mistakes. Mm-hmm. And I feel I am nowhere close to perfecting that, but I do see the benefits, enormous benefits of that beginning to kick in. Mm-hmm. And where I see that is because when now people look at me, mm-hmm. I've always found your character, people see through that within 5 or 10 minutes. It happens not because of the words that you speak, it's because of the energy that surrounds you. It's amazing how so quickly you know about a person even without the words. You know, you look beyond the words that people speak. Mm-hmm. And I think that energy changes around only by consciously, constantly revisiting your inner self, mm-hmm. and saying, what is the energy that I'm sending out to this world? Mm-hmm. What is the energy that sends out? So the big change in one word is, 7 years ago, people used to look at me and say, not happy. 7 years later, people look at me and say, happy. And I think that one sentence, they sum it up.
That's a big, big change. I think people are in a pursuit of happiness and doing everything which we mentioned. And here you are with just going within and connecting with the Supreme. We can experience that good energy from you, the good vibes from you. You know, another thing which happens is that people say that, you know, I'm very busy. You see, aren't you busy? I'm sure you're busy. You've got your targets. You've got daughters. You've got your family. You've got parents. And you must be traveling also. And you've got, you know, things to achieve, of course. It's not that you don't achieve things, career point of view. Tell us, how have you maintained that balance? Were you able to maintain that balance or, including this practice of meditation? Tell us about your practice so that, you know, people can understand that being busy, being at a top position, being with multi roles, you can still experience something which you already have and connect with God.
Sister, really, you know, I'll say three things about it. Number one, my practice of meditation actually intensifies the more busy I get, because I find that to actually deal with a really busy day, I need to be present for every moment. Mm-hmm. And I think I always look at, say, you know, the previous day, if I find that the next day is going to be like a 12-hour work day, I've got like 15 meetings to do, mm-hmm. I will make sure that morning I meditate, because it gives me the power to be present from moment to moment and not let thoughts trail from one meeting to the other. Mm-hmm. Many a times I actually get tired, because by the time I'm into my 8th or 9th meeting, the thought process has basically been that I carry 8 meetings into my 9th meeting. Mm-hmm. And that, I mean, it's more mental fatigue rather than physical fatigue. I mean, physically, all of us in today's world are very comfortable, right? We sit in meetings, you know, it's not hard labor. Yet we call ourselves, oh, I'm so tired at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. So what really is quote unquote tiredness? It's not physical tiredness, it's mental tiredness. And meditation has helped me basically ensure that the mental fatigue factor can be reduced on a day-to-day life. Mm-hmm. So I actually consciously feel that 30-minute investment gives you so much more better return for people who look at this in a very logical sense. It's the best investment of 30 minutes you can make on a very busy day. Mm-hmm. But also then the second one is the outcome. Mm-hmm. The actual outcome of the meeting. If you go into a particular meeting, most meetings are meant to be, you know, not just discussions, or the conflict points are so high, because what happens in a corporate world is everyone comes in with their point of view. Everyone is extremely well informed. Mm-hmm. Decision making is not just a factual task or a intellectual task. It's many a time an emotional task and an interpersonal task. Again, meditation comes to great effect, because you're very well tuned into people's energy. You mm-hmm. understand what that person's motivation is. You are able to channelize things so much better. Mm-hmm. So I actually find that for anybody who's in a corporate world, mm-hmm. I look at the US education system today, mm-hmm. and I kind of feel that the education system that we subject our kids to is archaic. Mm-hmm. It was meant for a world where people were supposed to become engineers and doctors. At that time, the world needed them because, you know, it was an industrialized world which required more engineers, more doctors to come out. Today's world, in which it's not about engineering or doctor skills, it is interpersonal skills. It's about the ability to keep society happy. And in that way, meditation is equal, you know, is the one power that actually helps kids stay alive, stay happy, and build better societies for tomorrow.
Lovely. You know, you talked about a lot about your, the impact that it has had, you know, meditation has had on your work life. And how about your, you know, your relationship with your kids, with your wife, you know, with your relatives and friends? Has it improved? What is the change that you see?
Oh, tremendously, sister. I think, again, as I said, my definition of a relationship maybe 7 years ago was expectations, right? I loved my wife. I expected certain things. I love my kids. I actually felt that I put the burden of my expectation, not on them, on myself, that I colored with most relationships on the on that lens. I think one of the things that you ask, you realize is the true beauty of a relationship comes when you accept than expect. I think that small transformation has been brilliant. There was, you know, you asked me another question in the previous one, which I forgot to answer, which is, what is the one or two practices in our day-to-day basis that I do to make this happen? When I truly started valuing the power of spending time with myself, I find myself waking up at 4:45 every day today. That morning time of 5 to 5:30, because after 5:30, kids wake up, the house starts to get busy. But that quiet time in the morning, not with music, not with anything, spending with myself, is the best 30 minutes that I spend in a day. I can compromise on sleep, but I can't compromise on that 30 minutes right now. Well, earlier, I needed 8, 9, 10 hours of sleep. Now I find 6 hours is more than enough to recharge. But the 30 minutes, if I miss, I start sleeping a lot more. So,
Very, very, very nicely put. And, you know, also that you said that, you know, you've had this practice. So, and you travel. How do you get time to visit the centers? And, you know, how, why do you see a connect while visiting? What is that thing which you liked in the Brahma Kumaris, you know, which makes you keep coming again and again? And, you know, we understand that you're coming especially here from US to the retreat center, you know, for just one conference. And for it, there has to be something which pulls you. So what is that one thing that you really like about the BKs, or what is it that's got you connected, hooked rather?
I think, sister, for me, again, it's a very personal choice. One of the things which I tell most people is there are many paths to spirituality, and you know, people should choose some path, something they feel comfortable with. So this is not my own reason for picking up Brahma Kumaris was I liked the fact that I came to a center and I saw people who went through similar struggles as I do. And it kept things real, right? It didn't make me feel that to do this, I had to sacrifice my day-to-day life. It didn't make me feel that to do this, I had to wear a cloak of goodness all the time. It made me feel, you know what, I'm human. I am bound to make mistakes. But even while making that, you can give life a second, third, fourth, ultimate number of chances. And every time you give it a chance, you become a better person. And I think the connect with the brothers and the sisters, every time I visit a center, I come back with a renewed energy, that renewed belief that around me are people who are making very similar efforts. And when I see the collective joy, when I'm with my brother, you know, with the community, it feels, look at the amount of people that who come to Brahma Kumaris from all walks of life, from all aspects, you know. You shared your own story of coming in from a corporate world. I see other sisters who come in from, you know, there is no nationality, there is no community, there is no common thread, except that we are all here to improve ourselves. We all see ourselves as connected human beings and want to make the world a better place. So I think that's what drew me to Brahma Kumaris.
Brother, it's been lovely talking to you. You know, you've shared your experience of how meditation has changed your life. has given it a new meaning, the impact it has on your work and in your family life. And really, we all come from that same background of where we all were confused at some point. And I think everyone else is, when we think that we are the bodies, when we think that this is the material achievement, that's all that we have to do. And that is where things become become difficult, and there is a conflict. And so you've really clarified on many, many things, and I'm sure if people will listen to this conversation and, you know, hear it and look at it, I'm sure they'll be inspired to take the benefits of meditation and really make happiness part of their daily lives. So right. Thank you so much. But before we close, I think you share, what is your message for the audience?
Sister, I have, thank you for having me. All of us, the reason why when we go through life, you know, once our basic needs are met, you know, I call it the Maslow's hierarchy, right? We all first come for meeting our basic needs of food, clothing, and shelter. Mm-hmm. After that, we start looking for some other forms of pleasure. Mm-hmm. But most of us, once we go through those, we intelligent people will ask that extra question to saying that there's something missing in life. And I think the pursuit of happiness is the, call it the ultimate birthright that all of us have as human beings. Mm-hmm. So the one message which I will have for anyone out there is they should give themselves a chance to experience it. Mm-hmm. You know, when you can give yourself a chance to experience that beautiful car that you want to drive, the great house that you want to own, why wouldn't you give yourself a chance to the greatest gift that you have, which is exploring your own happiness? And I think to do that, what I have discovered personally is all of us, it requires discipline. Mm-hmm. It is not something which, you know, just the way, what if all of us were given an opportunity to go to a dream job one day, mm-hmm. the job that we all aspired for? And the first day we come to the job, we feel so much of happiness that, you know, we sit in the chair, we feel mad. We feel a sense that we have achieved something. But what if you sit on the job for 1 week, 1 month, 1 year and do nothing about it? All of a sudden, your best dream becomes your nightmare, right? Your pursuit of happiness is also one where, you know, you can't just put it for one moment. Mm-hmm. It's a daily practice. It requires you to commit to it. Mm-hmm. It requires you to be very conscious about your daily practice. Mm-hmm. But once you do that, what you get out of it is something which is perhaps the biggest gift that you can give yourself.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for that beautiful message. Thank you for coming and sharing your experience, and we hope to see more of you.
Thank you, sister. Om Shanti.
Om Shanti.